Hi everyone. So this lecture will be on the Sale of Goods Act, lecture number 2, covering out the second chapter of the Sale of Goods Act. The concept that will be covered is the conditions and warranties. So Sale of Goods Act, the second unit, conditions and warranties. That is the chapter that we are going to cover. So this particular chapter is very, very important. The unit number 2 is very, very important from the examination's point of view as well, covering the concept called as a conditions and warranties. So what extent this is important and what are all the important concepts that we require to cover from the exam point of view, that let us try to cover. So first one, Sale of Goods Act, unit number 1 and 2 and 4 are very, very important from the exam's point of view. 1, 2 and 4. 3 is also important, but 1, 2, 4 frequently asked in examinations. So 1, 2 and 4. So 4 is unpaid seller, such concepts will be there. So in this particular topic, we are going to discuss about the concept of conditions and warranties. What is the concept? Conditions and warranties. Okay. So what is this conditions and warranties? Let's try to understand. From the institute study material only we need to read this chapter. There is no alternative for this, only institute material, because the questions directly come from the institute study material. Okay, now see here. So the topic name is conditions and warranties. What is condition? What is a warranty? Let us try to understand. See here. What is a condition? What is a warranty? Okay, so the word warranties is derived from a singular word called as a warranty. From this, the word warranties came. The word warranty came from another English word called as a warrant. Warrant means what? Right. Okay, warrant means what? Right. So what are the conditions and rights with respect to the sale of goods is discussed in this particular chapter. Okay, now, so what is a condition? What is a warrant? Let us try to understand clearly. First, stipulation as to the time. So what is this? Let's try to understand. Sir, for having a contract of sale, essentials will be, there must be goods. These goods must be movable goods. These goods must be deliverable. Delivery can be either actual delivery or a constructive delivery or a symbolic delivery. Goods can be future goods or a present goods or a contingent goods, ascertained, unascertained, various concepts we have already covered in the previous lecture. If you didn't listen to the lecture number 1 to the Sale of Goods Act, please go back and listen to that lecture first. Okay, next issue. So, goods must be movable, must be deliverable. Okay. Now, this particular sale of goods must be made for a price. Must be made for what, sir? For a price. Okay. So, that price may be a normal price or an ascertained price by a valuer. That can be fixed by the parties or can be fixed by a third party as well. So, these are all the various essential elements to make a contract of sale. Okay. Goods must be there. Those must be movable, deliverable. There must be a price. When all these things are happening, it's called as a sale contract. When this sale have all the essentials of a contract under Contract Act, this will be called as a contract of sale. Okay. So now, what is more essential here? Goods must be there, movable, they must be deliverable. Price, stipulations as to the price. Now we are going to see the time. Stipulations as to the time. That means nowhere in the essentials they said about a time. Time of what? Time of two things. Time of delivery, time of price. Which is more important is the query. So hopefully no one will understand if I tell like this. But this is a basic thing that we need to understand to start this chapter, Sale of Goods Act. They said goods must be there. They said it must be movable. They said they are deliverable. And they also said that price must be payable. But when to deliver, when to pay the price is not said in the chapter number 1 what we read. This unit is going to concentrate completely on time concept. What is the relevance of the time with regard to the time of delivery and time of price payment? Okay, now listen carefully to the logic. What is the name of this chapter? Sale of Goods Act. Sale will be completed only if the goods are changing the hands from one person to another person. Because sale of goods, that means the delivery of the goods must be there. The transfer of goods must be there from one party to another party. Then only we will call it as a sale of goods. Okay. Therefore, what law is saying is, time is important for delivery, not for payment. Means what? For example, A and B entered into a contract of sale. A said, I will sell the goods to you. When you will sell, you have to tell that mandatorily. Okay. So, he will tell that, I will sell and I will deliver the goods to you on the same date. When you will deliver, the time when you are going to deliver me the goods, you need to tell that very, very clearly in the contract of sale itself. Okay. When you will pay the price for this goods that are supplied to you, that may be paid at the time of delivery, that may be paid even after delivery, or that can be paid as advance even before the delivery. Payment is not criteria because purchase can be a credit purchase as well. Okay, purchase can also be what's a credit purchase. Purchases will be of two types. B is a purchaser, A is a seller. A made a cash sale, price will be paid immediately. A made a credit sale, price will be paid in future. So, payment making is not important for contract. The contract of sale will be completed on delivery of the goods. On what's a delivery of the goods? I will give you classic example for this. Listen, A, B entered into a contract. Contract for sale. A will sell, B will buy. Okay. A will sell, B has to buy. They said that I will buy the goods from you. I will buy the goods from you on 10th December, he said. Okay. A said that, yes, I am agreeing to that. But pay some token advance such that I can believe that you will really buy on 10th December. He said that, okay, I will pay you. So, total contract value is 1 crore. Pay 10 lakhs, he said. 10%, 10 lakhs he paid. Sale completed, huh? No, because only payment of price is made as an advance. That means here the payment is a criteria, but that is not the only important thing. The main stipulation to the sale is not the time of payment, is the time of delivery. Okay, so on 10th December, goods are given from A to B, transferred from A to B on a sale. Now I will tell sale is completed, but price is due because this is a credit sale. So, the time is important for payment. The time is important for delivery. Delivery is important, not the price. Price you can pay before, some payment you can make before or at the time or even future life you pay. No issue. Time of payment is not so much important. It is a time of delivery, which is very, very important for a contract of sale. That is what said in stipulation as to the time. Let's see this. Unless a different intention appears from the terms of contract, stipulation as to the time of payment are not deemed to be the essence of contract of sale. That is important, but that is not the only essence. Okay, so that means, what do you mean by unless a different intention appears in the terms of contract? In the contract terms itself, they have clearly written that payment making is very, very important for the essence. Then only it is important, or else you can make the payment before or during or even after the contract. So that's what analyzed here. This is only a analysis. Okay, if you want, you can read that. As regard to the time for payment of price, unless different intention appears on the terms of contract, the stipulation as regard this is not deemed to be. Same thing he has said again. But delivery of goods must be made without a delay. Whether or not such a stipulation is essence of contract depends on the terms agreed. Okay. So, this is the point. Price for the goods may be fixed by the contract or may be paid even or fixed later in a specified manner. Stipulation as to the time of delivery are usually the essence. That means time of payment is less superior than time of delivery of the goods. Okay, that's all. So simply in one word, if you want to conclude whatever is discussed till now, time of payment is, or time of delivery is, superior to the time of payment unless otherwise provided. That means if in the contract itself they said that sale will be completed only on payment, there is no credit sale concept, then price also will become essence, or else price is less superior when compared to delivery. Next, conditions and warranties. Sir, what is this conditions and warranties? In the first chapter, we unit number one, we learnt only what are the essentials, goods, mobile, etc. Now we are going to go deep into that and analyze under what conditions the sale will be made. Under what conditions the sale will be made. Sir, what are conditions? What is a warranty? Let's try to understand that very clearly before we start with the concept. So next one. Conditions and warranties. Sir, stipulation is of two types. Stipulation as to the condition, stipulation as to the warranty. What is a stipulation? What is a condition? What is a warranty? Before we understand that, first we need to know what is a stipulation. Stipulation is something which forms part of a contract and which is affecting a contract. That means stipulation, when you write a contract terms and conditions, when you write the terms and conditions, in the terms and conditions, one of the stipulation, one of the condition or term, whatever you write, is called as a stipulation. Okay, that stipulation will be forming part of the contract and it will affect the contract. That means if you don't do that, it leads to breach. That's called as affecting the contract. You must do that. That must do things in a contract is called as a stipulation. Okay, that stipulation are of two types, serious and non-serious. Important, unimportant, superior and inferior. Superior stipulations are called as conditions. Not that much superior, but important are called as warranties. Very, very important, superior. Significant, superior. Less significant, warranties. More significant stipulations will be called as conditions. Less significant stipulations are called as warranties. 1 point completed. Next, condition and warranty. See here, what is the most important subject matter of a contract of sale is called as a condition. Just additionals to that main contract are called as warranties. Are called as what, sir? Warranties. Sir, example, see here. I want, and listen carefully, I will take a small classic easy example from lifetime examples. Okay, I said I want 10 cages of onions. Okay, I want 10 cages of onions. Here 10 cages is condition, onions is a condition. If you give me only 5 cages, breach. If you give 12 cages, breach. If you give 10 cages but tomatoes, breach. There two things are very, very important stipulations as to conditions were given. Am I clear? Okay. I said you have to pay 100 rupees per, you have to pay 30 rupees per kg. Let's say for example, I'm very bad at tracking onion prices. Take for example, 30 rupees per kg I said. So 30 rupees, okay. If I say 100 cages, kg is 30 rupees, 3000 rupees is the price to be paid. Clear everyone? Now listen carefully to the logic. I said like this, you have to pack this onions in white color cover and you need to pay me the 3000 in 100 rupee currency denomination. I said like this. Now listen, another party who is a buyer or another party who is a seller, on that day he sold the onions, 10 cages, onions only, packed in a sky blue color cover, and he has paid in 100 rupee denomination. Now he said that I ask you to pack in a white color cover, but you packed in a blue color cover. Therefore, there is a breach of contract, he said. Breach, overreaction. If you are so serious, take it as a cancellation of contract. But generally, onions and 10 kg onion and a blue color cover, if you compare, which is more important here? Onions of 10 kgs is important. Cover is irrelevant here. But if you are so much important about, if you are so much specific about white color, you can cancel the contract. You can, or you can collect damages from me. That means I asked you for white color, but you have given me a blue color. I was hurt. Because of that, I can collect a damage. But you can't cancel the contract of sale. Because the sale is nowhere relevant to the cover color. And same thing, you want 3000. You said 100 rupee, but it is not possible. I couldn't find. Therefore, I am giving you 6 3000 rupee notes. How many? 6 500 rupee note, counting to rupees 3000. Okay. So, like that I have paid. He said that just you paid 500 rupee notes, 6 notes you have given for 3000. I will cancel the contract, he said. Overreaction. You have to pay 3000. You have to be paid 3000. I paid 3000. Then what is the problem? That's called as a warranty. I think everyone in the class understood what is the idea behind this. Okay. So therefore the point is, which is most significant and essential is called as a condition. Which is an additional condition but not so significant are called as a warranty. Those are called as a collateral. Collateral means additional. Okay. Let's see. A condition is a stipulation. First, it's a stipulation. Essential to the main purpose of the contract, the breach of which, if the condition a breached, it lead to repudiation of contract, means cancellation of contract. Okay, next example you can read later. Let's go to the main point. Warranty is a stipulation. This is also a stipulation, but less serious stipulation. Less serious stipulation, which is additional to the main purpose, breach of which cancel of contract will not be there. It can only claim for damages, but not right to reject the goods and treat the contract as repudiated. And this cannot happen. You can't cancel the contract. You can only claim damages for not following the procedure properly. Next. So, try to understand this clearly. Okay. Let us try to understand clearly. Whether a stipulation is in a contract of sale is a condition or warranty depends in each case of a construction of the contract. Construction may not building construction, in a construction of a contract. A stipulation may be a condition, though called as a warranty in a contract. Sir, what does it mean? Whether a stipulation in a contract of a sale is a condition or warranty depends on each case. What does it mean? Listen carefully. A person is a covers seller, hand covers will be there, na? That seller. Another buyer is there. Buyer clearly said that I want to buy white color cover. He sent blue color. Now you can't tell it's a warranty. It is a warranty in the onions example. It is a condition in this example. Therefore, the concept that you need to understand is, always you can't tell that blue color red cover is a contract of warranty. It's not a condition for sale. It's a condition of warranty. It's a warranty. You can't tell like that. It depends on each case of the contract. That's what Institute Study Material want to convey. Whether it is a condition or warranty depends on the case. For a banker, denomination of 100 rupee and 500 rupee notes is very, very important. But it may not be so important in case of onions example. For a bank person, that 100 rupee denomination is very, very important for him. So, always you can't tell that this is a condition or this is a warranty. It depends on the facts of the case. It depends on what's the facts of the case. Okay, next. All these are examples, sir. I don't want to read these examples and waste your precious time at the exams time. So I don't want to, I want to tell what is the main idea. After that you can read. Okay. Problem, I am getting almost hundreds of messages every day. We can't understand sale of goods act. And I am really, really very, very sorry that I couldn't attend to all your messages, because in the last 12 days, one of my family member is standing up for CASIRC elections. So I was very, very busy in canvassing for him.
okay, around in and around Andhra Pradesh, etc., these areas, Hyderabad, all these areas I am going for a canvassing. So CA also have elections. Okay, one of our close relative is a chartered accountant having 35 years of experience. He's standing for the elections this time. So for the Southern India Regional Council, the total Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Kerala, all these areas put together, one of our family member, close relative, is standing for the elections this time. So I was very busy in doing that canvassing work. Don't think otherwise. Why I am not taking session? If 1 minute time, if I get, I will definitely do that for this CA Foundation students. So please try to understand my problem also. In the meanwhile, I have to do all these works. So I was not in the station first. I'm not in Hyderabad. So I'm here and there. I'm going for canvassing work. So please try to understand my problem also. Okay. So if 1 minute time, if I get, I'm heartfully telling, I will dedicate it for the CA Foundation students for the coming attempt. Okay. Because many students are really, really feeling very, very bad about Sale of Goods Act and Contract Act. I don't know what is the reason exactly is. But after listening to the lecture, they are feeling comfortable. So anyway, let's have a time to complete this particular chapter as well. When conditioned to be treated as a warranty. Okay. Sir, what is this concept? Already we said that condition warranty is there. Conditions are important things. Warranties are important but less important when compared to the condition. But when conditioned to be treated as a warranty. Let's read. First, let us read the concept. Where a contract of sale is a subject to any condition to be fulfilled by the seller, the buyer may waive. Okay, waive means excuse in a normal English language. Okay, relief you can call like that. May provide a relief. Waive means providing a relief or provide a relief. Okay. So where a contract of sale is subject to any condition to be fulfilled by the seller, the buyer may waive the condition or elect to treat the breach of condition as a breach of warranty and not as a ground for treating the contract as repudiated. Where a contract of sale is not severable and the buyer has not accepted the goods or part thereof, the breach of any condition to be fulfilled by the seller can only be treated as a breach of warranty and not as a ground for rejecting the goods and treating the contract as repudiated. Unless there is a term of the contract expressed or implied to that effect. Nothing in this section shall affect the case of any condition or warranty fulfilled of which is excused by law by reason of impossibility or otherwise. Sir, one point also I didn't understand. Take 1 minute time. Read it properly first. I will go into analysis. Completed? So listen here. Let me explain this concept very clearly. See here. Sir, condition, if it is satisfied, very good. If you breach the very condition of the contract, I can have a repudiation of contract. Means what? Cancel the contract. Instead of canceling the contract altogether, the buyer can treat the breach of condition as a breach of warranty. Means what? Listen carefully. I said, I want grade 1 quality cement to construct a small room. Okay, I want a grade 1 quality cement. The contractor to whom I have given the contract to buy, okay, that means the seller who has to sell me the cement, he said that each bag will be 1000 rupees. Example sake, let us take each bag cost is 1000 and I want 100 bags of cement of grade 1 quality. Constructing the room is very, very important and it has to be completed in another 15 days. Once I start constructing today, in 3-4 days I can construct and it has to be given some time to fit correctly. That concreteness has to come. It takes, I have only 15 days to complete the construction. One room must be covered. So, I ordered to purchase 100 bags of cement of 1000 rupees each of grade 1 quality. This is what agreed in the contract of sale. Okay. The seller has sold me grade 2 quality. That means one step below this grade 1 quality cement. Okay. Generally, this will be costing 800 in the market. Okay. Now, I believe in that seller and I purchase. Later, I found after purchasing the goods, after accepting the goods, I came to know that he has supplied me grade 2 quality instead of grade 1. Now, what I can do? I have two choices. Choice number one, I can cancel the contract altogether. Cancel the contract. But if you cancel the contract, construction of room will also get delayed. I can't afford that. Therefore, what I thought, anyway, construction of room must be done. Let's start with grade 2 cement. But that means what I have done, even though you have breached the grade, I am waiving the condition. I am excusing you. I said, okay, no problem. But I am not excusing you totally. Okay. I am treating breach of condition as a breach of warranty. Means what? It is really a condition breach. But I am now treating it as a breach of warranty. Means what? I am not going to cancel the contract, but I am going to collect damages from you. Means what? That extra 200 I paid, na? 200 rupees is there. 200 into 100 bags, 20,000 I will collect from you as a damage. This is what he want to tell. This is what he said even here. Okay? Next issue. Analysis points I am not going to read and waste your time. Main content I am going to explain in this revision class. Next. Express and implied conditions and warranties. Express and implied conditions and warranties. See here. Conditions and warranties may be either express or implied. Express means clearly they were written in the contract. Implied means generally by law they are implied. Okay, generally by law they are implied conditions. Okay, so see here. Express conditions are those which are agreed upon between the parties at the time of contract and are expressly provided, means in the written form they are provided in the contract. Implied conditions are presumed by law. Presumption means what? That Tamil word, what it is? Nanikirade. Something like that. Okay. So, presumed by law to be present in the contract. It should be noted that an implied condition may be negated or waived by an express agreement. Sir, what is negated and waived? We will see. So, simply two points we need to understand. There are two types of conditions. Clearly, you said grade 1 quality, grade 2 quality, red color, white color. You clearly said, or you said onions, tomatoes. These are all express conditions. Now, implied conditions we are going to deal. What are those implied? Very, very important for the coming December 21 exams. Implied conditions. One question from any of these seven can come in the coming examination. In these six are important. Okay, one point is similar to the previous one. Six technical points will be there. Six points are ultimately important for exam. Any one point he can take, he create a case law and he will ask in exam. Okay, now see here. Condition. There are six implied conditions. Sir, can you please explain me what is an implied condition in a simple way? Yes, I can explain. See here. A, B. B approached A. He said, I want your car. You are selling a car, na? I want this car. Okay. A is a seller, B is a buyer. Seller said to B, I will sell you car. B said to A, okay, I will pay you the price for the car. How much? 10 lakhs, 10 lakhs. Agreed amount, 10 lakhs. A said 10 lakhs, B also no, with no bargain. He said, okay, I'm ready to pay 10 lakhs. Which car I want to purchase? For example, Honda City. Example. Which color I want to purchase? Black color. Okay. Pearl black color will be there in city. I want to purchase that. Okay. Petrol or diesel? He said, oh, no, I don't want a diesel. I want petrol version for a smooth drive. Okay. Like this, they have said everything. Okay. Now, all conditions are satisfied by A. All conditions are satisfied by A. A has sold actually on the said date Honda City, black, pearl black color, petrol version, and whatever the design he wants, same thing, everything was sold. Now all the conditions are satisfied. Now there is a implied condition in this. Do you know what is an implied condition? Title. Title. What is title? It is implied that A is the owner of this particular Honda City first. If he is stealing it, if he got that Honda City out of a theft and sold to B, it is an implied condition. That means you need not clearly tell, I am the owner of the goods. When you are selling, I presume that you are the real owner. That's called as a presumed by law. Title is presumed always. It's an implied condition. Okay, later B A should not tell B, you asked me to sell car, but you didn't ask whether I am the owner of that good or not. Over action, we imply that you are the owner. Sir, for example, you go to a shop, you ask for a you ask for a mobile phone. Okay, you ask for mobile. What you will ask? I want this mobile phone with this much internal storage, this much RAM, this much speed, this much camera. Like that, we will ask. You will not ask, are you really purchasing this? Are you got this item as a theft? Are you robbed this? Are you ransacked it from some place? Or it is really you paid? Will you ask all these questions to the shop owner? We presume that he didn't do the all the things. That's called as an implied condition. How easy if you understand like this. Okay. So condition as to the title. Title means the ownership. So in every contract of sale, unless an agreement to the contrary, the first implied condition on the part of the seller, the first implied condition on the seller is he has a right to sell. Okay. In case of agreement to sell, means in future he will sell, he will have right to sell at the time when the property is to pass. That means at the time the expiry date comes, he has a right. Okay. So this is what he want to tell. Next. Sale by description. Sale by description. So what it is, let us see first. So next one is, as already said, sale by description. Sir, what is sale by description? I said I want to purchase 1,000 bags of cement of grade 1. Grade 1 is a description here. If description is not followed properly, that means A, B entered into contract. A, B entered into contract. Okay. Now, A, B entered into contract. A sold goods. B bought goods from A. Paid consideration. When agreed consideration is paid by B to A, B can presume that, our contract will presume that A is also supplying what are the goods that are promised by A at the beginning. Grade 1 only you are giving, that I will presume. Okay. That's why it's called as an implied condition. Okay. If the description is not properly followed, you have two options. Now, first, number one, you need not accept the goods. The buyer is not bound to accept the goods and pay for the goods. Second option is also available, which you have already completed. What is that? You can convert that breach of condition into breach of warranty. Implied condition will be converted into breach of warranty and you can claim damages. That's already we have discussed. Okay. So this is what sale by disc. All remaining are examples. So don't see the size of answer. See the content covered. These are all examples only. Read the content. Sale by sample. Sir, what is a sale by sample? See here. When we go into the store, he is shown a sample to us. Sir, this is a sample.
like this only, all the other goods will be there. That means when you show me wheat, when you show me cotton, okay, for example, I went to a supermarket, a store. I said I want to purchase 60 rupees Sona Masuri rice. He shown me a sample. He took some amount into his hand and he poured that rice into my hand and he said, so please taste at least 5-6 grains of rice and then confirm whether you like this or not. So I have taken that. Okay, I consumed some grains of rice and I said that yes, this is the best quality. I want 100 bags like this. When 100 bags comes to me, what presumption that I will make? What is implied? These 100 bags contain the sample grains of rice whatever I have ate already. Okay, so therefore, whenever you shown me a sample and on the basis of that sample the original contract is getting formed, there are three implied conditions. Condition number one, bulk corresponds to same in quality. Sample 10 grains whatever I ate, that same quality should be there also for all the bulk 100 cages or 100 bags, whatever the case may be. Next, the buyer shall have a reasonable opportunity of comparing bulk with the sample. That means you should also give, the seller should give the buyer a chance to compare bulk with the sample. That means he should also give a chance. Okay, I will also take another 10 grains randomly from some of the bags. I will compare. So three things. Number one, first thing, we presume that bulk corresponds to the sample. Second one, give me a chance to check. Third one, the goods shall be free from any defect rendering them unmerchantable. What is merchantable? Merchantable means non-sellable. Okay, so the goods shall be free from any defect, okay, which would not be apparent on reasonable examination of sample. Okay, let's read. The goods shall be free from any defect rendering them unmerchantable, which would not be apparent on reasonable examination of sample. This condition is applicable only with regard to defects which could not be discovered by an ordinary examination of goods. If the defects are latent, then the buyer can avoid the contract. This simply means the goods shall be free from any latent defect, that is a hidden defect. Sir, what does it mean? Let's try to understand with an example. So what does this mean? Let's try to understand. Defects are of two types. Identifiable apparent defect. Apparent defect means when you see the good itself on the face, you can tell there is a defect. Some defects you can't understand unless and until there is a good examination. Okay. When I see the rice, it seems to be good. But when I try to cook by putting it into the water, it is breaking totally. That means only on examination of a sample, I can know whether it is of a correct quality or not. In such case, if there are any hidden defects which buyer can't identify in the sample, then he can avoid the contract. He can avoid the contract. Combination. When the description concept and sample concept correlates, when you combine both of them, that's called as a sale by sample as well as description. That means they shown a sample. I said, please supply 1,000 bags of cement. 1,000 bags of cement. Okay. I said, give me a sample packet such that I will test it home or I will test with my contractor. He said, okay, sir, take this bag, a small bag of cement he has given. Sample he has given. Okay. Description grade 1. Now, it is implied that the 100 bags of cement which I get in future will correspond to the same sample quality and will be of a same description. If not, the buyer can cancel the contract. Next. Quality or fitness. Quality or fitness. Sir, what is this? Let's read. Ordinarily, there is no implied condition as to the quality or fitness of the goods sold for any particular purpose. However, the condition as to the reasonable fitness of the goods for a particular purpose may be implied if the buyer had made known to the seller the purpose of his purchase. The purpose of his purchase
And relied upon the skill and judgment of the seller to select the best goods, and the seller has ordinarily been dealing in those goods. The implied condition will not apply if the goods have sold under a trademark or a patent name. Sir, what is this? So please read this first. Later we will be taking an analysis part. Please take a minute time and read that first. Read that two paragraphs, small paragraph 1 and 2. So let us understand this in an easy way. Sir, what do you mean by the condition as to the quality or fitness? Means what? Sir, quality or fitness means, listen carefully, what is this difference between quality and description? Grade 1 is not the quality, it's a description of the goods. Grade 2 is not the quality, it's a description. You are believing that grade 1 is having high quality, that's all. And we are not telling this is of a quality. We are telling grade 1 is good one. This is a good quality. But we are not telling that whether this is a quality which is fit for your purpose. Okay. Listen carefully. Listen carefully. I will explain in this way to make you easily understand. We want to celebrate. We want a person, a family want to celebrate a marriage function. Okay. Marriage function. Some occasion they want to celebrate. For that, they went to a crackers shop. They went to a cracker shop. They said, some items of whatever they use in Diwali occasion, whatever we can call it a blasting crackers, we can call it rockets, we can call it various ways are there, 100 shots will be there. Like that, various things will be there. They said, we want all these. Clear, everyone? Okay, so local made products will be there. He said, we want like this. This quality we need to get. Okay, now listen carefully. When you buy something believing that it will have that, even though if it doesn't work, you can't make any complaint against him, because quality is not guaranteed always. I will only tell that this is the description of the good. You want 1000 shots, you want 100 shots, I will sell that. On the packet, it will be written 100 shots. Whether really it will be having 100 shots or it will stop with 95, I can't give a guarantee as to the quality. But second stage, second example. I went to a cracker shop. I asked the seller now. I will be believing you. Okay? That means I said very, very clearly. There is a marriage function. Okay? We want 100 shots. Exactly 100 times it should blast. Okay, that means a buyer made known to the seller the purpose for which goods are required. And I said, seller, I am believing in you. You select the correct cracker and give to me. Now I am not voluntarily selecting. In that case, let the buyer be aware, will get attracted. KVA tempter. But I don't want that to happen. I am relying on the skill and judgment of the seller. I asked the seller, please give me a correct product for this. I relied on the skill. And it must be of a description dealt by the seller. Seller should be a dealer of that particular crackers. Then only all these conditions should happen. Will be satisfied. Clear, everyone? That means generally quality is the headache of the buyer. Let the buyer be aware. However, if three conditions are satisfied, buyer said the seller very clearly the purpose for which he want to buy, and he relied on the skill and judgment of the seller, and he is a dealer of that good, whether he may be manufacturer or not. In these three cases, if the three conditions are satisfied, in that case, quality also becomes an implied condition. Also become implied condition. That means when I tried to blast it, 10 times only it blasted, after that. how I can sue the seller for the damages because it is not of the quality which I relied on the skill and judgment of that particular seller. Next, condition as to the marketability. So see here, let the buyer be aware concept will get applied for quality. When if I voluntarily select the product, but if I am relying on the seller to select something, then risk passes to the seller. Next, condition as to the marketability. Let us read first. Where goods are bought by description from the seller who deals in the goods of that description, there is an implied condition that goods shall be of a marketable quality. Sir, one point I forgot to tell. I am very sorry. See here, in this previous example, concept A does not apply. The condition of quality cannot apply. That means breach of quality cannot apply if you purchase trademark products or a trademark or a patented product. Means what? Standard fireworks will be there. Standard is a brand which is patented. What is standard here? Standard is a product which is branded. We believe that it will work. Even if all these three conditions are satisfied and the standard firework doesn't work properly, you can't sue the seller because even seller will also rely on the trademark or the patent. For example, Apple has a trademark and a patent in that name. I purchase, but it is not working properly. Seller also can't be sued because he will also believe in that same patent and trademark of Apple. Clear? In that case, you can't sue. Buyer can't sue the seller if the product is bad. If the product is of a sold on a trademark or a patent name. Next, condition as to the marketability. Where the goods are bought by description from a seller who deals in the goods of that description, there is an implied condition that goods shall be of a marketable quality. There are two requirements for this condition to apply. Goods should be bought by description and the seller should be dealer of that description. That means same like quality. Now the description of the goods. That means when I am purchasing the goods from you, I ordered for grade 1 means you should be giving only grade 1. For example, I will give one example. See here. There are two types of cement packets or cement products are there. Okay, let's say Penna cement is there, Nagarjuna cement is there. Both are popular. Now listen carefully. A person is not a dealer of Nagarjuna cement. He is a dealer of Penna cement clearly on the board. Okay, I went inside and I said, I want Nagarjuna cement bags. Okay, seller is not a dealer of that goods now. Now, if he sent Penna cement, you can't sue him because I am not a dealer. You should know that first. Let the buyer be aware. Second one, you are a dealer of Penna cement and I said very clearly grade 1 of Penna cement. If you sell another cement like Nagarjuna cement bag if you sell or if you are selling grade 2, then the buyer can sue the seller. Okay, that's the idea behind. That's all. So these are all certain important conditions that you need to read. So implied warranty is just read and leave, not so great and difficult, easy concept only, just put a reading and leave. Caveat emptor concept, we will be seeing it in fourth chapter. Unpaid seller concept is there. At that particular chapter, we'll be discussing caveat emptor. There is a linking to that. Okay, we'll be covering there in the chapter number, unit number 4 of the Sale of Goods Act. Okay, so this is the idea, whole idea behind unit number 2 of Sale of Goods. Sir, I can go very, very deep and analyze this chapter. It will take around 4 to 5 hours time in a normal session. Normal session, it takes around 5 to 6 hours time to explain with examples, notes, writing, everything. But for us, time is very little. But we need to pass first. To pass out, first we need to know the concept. So that is covered in this particular session. Hope everyone can understand the concept behind this chapter, Sale of Goods Act, unit number 2. Okay, so thank you very much. We'll be coming back with the next lecture. Thank you very much. Okay, bye.